We're very excited to be joined on our US Open preview episode by a guest who is such a well-respected tennis mind that he's been asked to simultaneously coach two of the greatest tennis legends of all time. His impressive resume includes playing at the University of Miami, being a professional player on the ATP, later a tennis club professional, and also a father of three. Now he's coaching both Serena and Venus Williams, and as the US Open is about to get underway, we're thrilled to talk to Eric Heckman. Eric, welcome to Matchpoint Canada.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah, we really appreciate the opportunity. And I mean, Mike gave a great rundown of your pretty detailed background in the sport, obviously playing college tennis, brief stint as a pro, and then venturing over to club professional, now coaching two of the greatest. Just in terms of your background in tennis, was it something your parents played? And when did you kind of get into it and realize maybe this is something you wanted to do further?
No, actually, I'd say nobody in my family was really an athlete, so I was a first, and tennis actually wasn't my first choice. It kind of by default wasn't allowed to play football, and boxing was, I guess, it was a little too dangerous, so ended up being a tennis player. But I love the individualism of it, and haven't left it since, so.
Seems like it was a good decision now as you see what you've accomplished and looking back on things as well in your career as a coach and player. Gonna ask you, of course, there's been a lot of buzz in your life since earlier this summer. I would imagine since you began coaching a second Williams sister, what reaction have you received from people inside and outside of the tennis world since you've undertaken coaching Serena alongside her sister Venus?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's been a good amount, you know. So it is unusual on the tour to coach two players, and kind of just happened. And it's mainly due to Venus, you know. So I've got a very, very good and strong relationship with Venus. She's awesome as a person, as a friend, and it kind of went from there. So.
Of course, so many different coaches have different personalities, different philosophies. Is there something that you, I guess, consistently bring in terms of your coaching philosophy on court? And is that something you ever have to adapt when maybe, you know, your two clients are two of the most high profile stars in our sport?
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's different aspects to coaching. I'd say my personality is my personality, but you know, there's different ways I approach them when I talk to them. They have different games to a certain extent, and how I coach them from a technical, strategic, and aspect. I mean, I'd say myself, I am kind of to the point, direct, and a little more pry. Laid back, not the in your face type of coach, equating it to basketball, equated more to like a Phil Jackson versus Bobby Knight. So definitely. So if you had to kind of make two contrasts.
Well, that's funny that you said that you're to the point because I was reading a piece by Christopher Clary in the New York Times. Your longtime friend Evan was quoted in that story calling you brutally honest. I suppose have you always been wired that way? And is that messaging ever tough to get across to certain players, especially when they are of such high pedigree?
Yeah, I mean, today I actually had it's like a 8 or 9 year old kid that I've coached when I'm in Miami at my club, and his dad sent me this article, actually a YouTube video, Tony Nadal talking about, you know, I guess he sent it to me for a purpose, that he's talking about how it's good to tell people the truth, you know. And I think it's always been something as a coach, as a player, that, you know, you can beat around it, but if you don't face the music at some point, you know, whatever the problem is, whatever the positive is, all you're ending up doing is avoiding the inevitable. So, you know, that's just everyone's got their quirk, and that's mine. And you know, so far with these two, I think that's appreciated, and sometimes it's not, but it is who I am, you know. So
I would imagine they're pretty direct in reverse as well with you at times, right?
Absolutely. And I appreciate that as well. You know, Venus is very direct and straight to the point, and I think that's why we connect so well.
You mentioned earlier how close a relationship you've developed with Venus over the years, not just as coach, but as friend as well. What's it been like since working with Serena, albeit on a shorter sample size here so far just this summer? What's impressed you the most with her in the short time you've been her coach?
Yeah, I mean, they're definitely different. Serena, I'd say it's more her intensity when she gets out there. You know, you can feel her presence, and it's, you know, it's just from her warm up with her wardrobe and everything, you can feel it's like that boxer coming straight into that ring with that energy, ready to go, ready to throw some blows. So, yeah, I mean, in tennis, you always, as a coach, you always try to teach intensity. That's one thing you definitely don't have to teach to Serena Williams. It's there every second of every practice.
I caught the last practice that she had here in Toronto before her match against Belinda Bencic, and there was just such a buzz around the stadium and around the grounds. And of course, Serena chose that time while she was in Toronto to drop a pretty big revelation on the tennis world, the sporting world at large. What was your reaction to Serena's retirement announcement, and how does it change now how you work with her as she approaches the finish line of her magnificent career?
Yeah, I mean, a good friend of mine that I had worked with, Prim Sirapat, she actually, you know, she does a lot of different pieces on this, on how players exit the sport from retirement. And Serena and Venus are both unique, and the way that Serena approaches, I think, is unique in her own style, obviously, and in her own narrative. And, you know, I think it's great. It's what she wants to do. And, you know, she came in on her terms. She's going out on her terms. And as I coach her, I know it's a lot of big moments every time you step into a match, you know, thinking, hey, this is my last one in Canada. This is my last one here. But she's had so many great moments in each place. I think it's a way to enjoy each of these moments now. Once you've accomplished what she's accomplished, it alleviates a lot of pressure, right? Won the U.S. Open countless times, Wimbledon countless times, Toronto, Cincinnati. So as you go through these events and you're like, hey, you know, I've been there, I've done that, I've won it, you know, it's pretty cool the way that she's going about it.
Yeah, you touched on her incredible intensity, which Mike mentioned we saw in practice in Toronto. I suppose maybe could you talk a little bit about her mindset at this stage now that it is public that she will be retiring? Is there any change in how she's approaching things at all, or is it pretty kind of business as usual?
I think it's very, very much the same. You know, I think that's something obviously that she decided, and you know, unbelievable career from 15 years old to 40. Incredible, right? So I think she's going about it in a very similar fashion. I know she's busy with all the business that she's got going on, so I'm sure that's, you know, that's a little stressful. But as far as tennis is concerned, same as if she was popping in there and she was 25 years old, you know, so same focus, same details, everything's the same.
And of course, U.S. Open now, our final slam of the season. We saw Serena hitting with Maria Sakkari the other day. There was some footage of that. Just wanted your overall thoughts on the women's field this season. Of course, we know there's a lot of parity on the WTA. We know Iga Swiatek's had an incredible year. Any players in mind maybe you would view as top favorites, or how are you looking at it?
Yeah, I mean, I was talking about this with Jarmir today, man, it's so open, you know. So if I had to pick a favorite, I don't even think I really could. I mean, you can go through and you can see that Caroline Garcia just won Cincinnati. I mean, you can't ever count out Saka. You can't count out Serena. You can't count out Venus. you can't count out Swiatek. I mean, you can go down the list. I could probably create a list of 40 players that I can make an argument that could win this tournament. It could lose first round, right? So it's the parity in the field is incredible, and there's going to be incredible matches all the way from the first round up until the final. So I think that's actually what's so interesting about the women's game. You know, the when the guys game, you got Roger and Novak and Rafa in there, you basically are like, okay, you know, these guys, at least one or two of them's a lock, right? You go into the women's field, it's like, who's coming out of there? And yeah, it's great, you know, to have those big names at the end of the tournament for the fans, et cetera, because, you know, people relate to them. But as far as growing tennis, it's great. You know, if I'm a young girl out there and I'm 8, 9 years old, and you have so many different winners of each WTA tournament, I wish I knew how many different WTA winners there were in 2022. I bet you the figure is staggering, and even 2021. So, you know, if you put that out there, if I'm a young girl, I'm like, man, I can do this. I can break through. I can be a professional tennis player, champion, et cetera. So it's interesting.
And having it somewhat wide open like that is going to lend to people speculating of what Serena can do in her last US Open, of course. And any tennis fan would love to see her push into the tournament a little bit here. What would be a successful US Open in your mind for her and also for Venus at this stage?
Yeah, I mean, look, you know, I mean, a question like that, obviously, as a champion, successful US Open is winning the tournament, right? But as a coach, it's just taking care of what's in front of you in that moment and not looking too far ahead, preparing tonight, eating healthy, relaxing, waking up tomorrow, preparing for practice the way, right way, having a good practice with a good purpose, finishing your practice properly, getting your cool down done the right way. So each detail as you enter one of these major tournaments, you know, from a week in advance, is very important to put you in the right mind frame, physical. So yeah, I mean, that's it's easy to, and that I'm sure it's racing through their heads at some point, right? But to kind of block those thoughts out, they just have to stay in the moment each day and in each second. So I think they will.
Speaking of preparation, as I was getting ready to speak with you today alongside Ben, going through possible questions, my kids were asking me, Dad, who are you interviewing tonight on the podcast? I said, oh, Serena and Venus Williams coach, actually. And my older son, who's turning 9 next month, said to me, Daddy coaches both of them. What if they have to play each other? And as unlikely a scenario as that seems, you know, full disclosure, we're recording this before the draw has been revealed. What would your reaction be? You know, God forbid they had to play each other at some point here.
I mean, obviously, I'd rather them not play each other. If they do, I had talked about that with Venus a little bit, kind of what her dad had done, et cetera. And, you know, one approach could be not to go to the match. And, you know, that way there's no point of reference for either girl to look at their coach. And the other one is to not sit in anybody's camp and kind of sit far away in the stands and be able to observe and watch the match. But, you know, it is what it is. If it happens, it's luck of the draw, right? So hopefully it doesn't happen. If it does, you know, I've done my best to prepare each of them, and I'm going to be fair to both of them.
You get a seat high up top on Ash where no one can spot you.
Yeah, hat, glasses, maybe a wig,
Full disguise.
mustache, the whole thing, you know.
Yeah, exactly. You mentioned early on how you love the individualism of tennis. I love that aspect too. And it's been a bit of a hot button topic, I think, this season. Coaching from the sidelines, how much a role should a coach maybe be able to play for their player? We see it on the WTA where a coaching timeout can exist outside of the slams. I guess, what's your stance on that? Do you believe a coach should be able to chat with their player for a couple of minutes, or should it be entirely sort of hands off?
Yeah, I mean, I honestly see both perspectives, and I kind of entered the tour right when you're allowed to start calling your player out to the court. And Venus had called me out there in Toronto the first time we went in 2019, and in Cincinnati. So I think as far as at the end of the day, if I were a player, I don't know if I'd really want to be coached, because I'd want, as a going through tennis, I've always thought of things in my own way, and I like the process of figuring it out. And if somebody sometimes while I'm competing is telling me something, maybe it breaks my train of thought, right? And I'm different sometimes than a lot of other players might be, right? Maybe they're just going on instinct and they're not thinking. At the same time, right, at the end of the day, it's a sport, and all athletes at the end of the day are entertainers for the fans. So having the option for it is great for the game, in my opinion, right? Having maybe a coach mic'd up and talking from the stands, or I personally like it better how each player at the WTA Tour had a coach being able to be called to the court. And then, you know, I remember with a few players, you have some heated exchanges, right? The player yelling at the coach, and sometimes some great exchanges, and sometimes some match changing. It's entertaining, you know? So I think it's, at the end of the day, for the sport, it's a good thing. Would I want it personally? Probably not, but you know, that's why I can see both sides. But I wouldn't say I'm a tennis purist. Everything changes in the world from tennis going forward, right? And you know, all you can do is look at something and say, hey, is this for the better or for the worse? And if it's for the better, you know, you got to adapt and change, right? That's just my approach.
No, that's a fantastic perspective. You had me thinking back to a few years ago when our Canadian Bianca Andreescu had a little coaching pep talk from former coach Sylvain Bruneau in the late stages of the Indian Wells final, and it seemed to inspire her to come back and defeat Angelique Kerber in three sets. I guess just to quickly follow up on that, if you are getting called, like, are you diving into tactics, or maybe are you saying something that would just kind of giving off like positive energy, or how would you approach that if you are called over by Venus or Serena?
It could be either, right? And that's where knowing your player, knowing how they'd react in a competitive moment, and watching some of their practice sets and tournaments can kind of give you a feel. Sometimes there's a match where there's, and it's easy to see from the stands because you're not playing, right? An obvious tactic that they should maybe employ. Sometimes it's the player kind of hurting themselves. Maybe they're upset, maybe they're nervous, maybe they're doubting themselves, whatever it might be. And then that's the emotional coaching. Good coach will figure out what information to relay and not overcoach, in the sense that, okay, here's your tactic, here's your mental, you know, you go through like 10 different things, and then the player short circuited in that 1 minute to 30 seconds, and they don't know what happened to them. So in that example that you gave, you know, I remember that, you know, that's how a coach can help change a match, right? So yeah. No, I think it completely varies based on the player and the situation.
I have to ask, because, sorry, Mike,
go ahead.
I have to ask because people are going to speculate. Is there any chance we could see a potential Venus-Serena doubles pairing at the U.S. Open?
There's, you know, I'm not going to say there's not a chance. I'm not going to say it's going to happen. So,
okay.
You know, I think you, me, and the rest of the world would love to see it happen. You know, in reality, they're, I don't know, I haven't calculated how many years they've been on tour, but, you know, they're probably the two oldest, and, you know, they're doing everything they can to prepare. And I think if they could play, I think that's something they would always want to do, as you've seen through their career. So only time will tell. And, you know, if they don't play, you know, they're still going to be both out there in this U.S. Open playing singles for sure.
Reading that Vogue magazine article, which was so powerful, so impactful, didn't specify exactly when Serena would hang up the racket, although I think most of us kind of figured it would be at the end of this U.S. Open. Is this her last tournament as a professional tennis player here?
Yeah, look, I don't want to exactly speak for her again. You know, I'll let her do the speaking for herself. The way I read it, it seems like that, you know. So, you know, but I'd say, like, she doesn't want to define it as retirement. I wouldn't want to either. And you saw with another great, Tom Brady, goes and he announces his retirement and then just misses the game, right? And before you know it, he's back out there in training camp and playing. So these elite athletes, and if you love to do it, you want to continue to do it, I'd say there's the door is never closed and not opening, never jammed.
Good point. You never know what could happen next, especially in tennis. There's been a history of players coming back as well. So I guess nothing would really surprise us.
No, who knows, right? So
we focused a lot of our questions on Serena, obviously, because we feel like, you know, time is running out here for her. But how does her retirement announcement, does it have any impact on Venus and what she does next? Have you guys discussed with the two of you, since you've been coaching her for a much longer time, what happens beyond this year's U.S. Open?
You know, I don't really discuss that with her. And Venus kind of flies under the radar, but man, I would say, yes, Serena is the greatest player of all time, in my opinion. And I'd put Venus at number two. Because if you really go through it and you're like, okay, how many finals did Venus lose to Serena? How many semis? How many, and Venus has beat her plenty of times too, right? But for everything Venus has overcome, from her syndrome, to battling her sister and still maintaining an unbelievable relationship, it's not easy. And she still has won 7 slams, right? I don't know, in singles, right? Let alone doubles, mixed doubles, 3 events in the tournament and winning all of them. So she's just, I do feel like she's a little underappreciated for all that she's accomplished. There's no doubt, but class act, the ultimate class act, right? I'd equivalent her, you got Roger on the guy side, you got Venus on the woman side, right? Like, of equals, in my opinion.
Well said.
Yeah, I'm glad we're not glossing over the doubles. I always point out that 14-0 in Grand Slam doubles finals without dropping a set. I don't think that's ever going to be matched in tennis history, to be honest.
Unbelievable, right? I mean, people look at them and they just talk about the singles. I mean, in my opinion, they're the greatest doubles team ever, mm-hmm. right? I mean, you walk out there and you get that many wins, and people don't even look at the mixed doubles, right? You can only play mixed doubles in Grand Slams. So, hey, let me pick you as my partner.
Not
let me
a,
play
not
a singles
a,
match, a doubles match, and a mixed doubles match all in the same day, right? So,
no kidding. Yeah, absolutely dominant. Well, Eric, thank you so much for taking the time, giving us not only your coaching perspective, but sharing some fantastic insights on two of the greatest players to ever play the game, Serena and Venus Williams. And good luck at this year's U.S. Open.
Thanks, guys. Looking forward to it, and have a great night.
Appreciate it. And especially on the cusp and the eve of the U.S. Open, for you to take the time like this amidst coaching not just one, but two superstar players. Yeah, it makes us appreciate your time even more. Cheers.
Appreciate it, guys. Have a great night.